In today's video, we have 3D printing versus silicone molds. So pretty much my entire life, I've been making my figures by pouring resin into silicone molds.
Then I got this 3D printer a few years ago, and I really haven't gone back. So I thought I would do a series of videos where I talk about the pros and the cons and the costs and how I specifically integrated it into my work, which I would put in the category of designer toys / sculpture. And then I thought I'd do a deeper dive into the 3D printing process, specifically using this machine, the Formlabs 3L. One of the biggest issues I've had with silicone molds is the size limitations. This is my 3-gallon pressure pot. I pressure cast all of my resin, which is definitely the way to go if you want clean castings with no bubbles. You can see here that this is kind of the maximum width, and here this is kind of the maximum height that I could get in this pot. And here are the figures that come out of those molds. So you could get some really nice small to medium small pieces, but that is about it. The build volume for the 3L is 13 by 8 by 12, so taking into consideration that I don't have to have a silicone mold in here, that's a pretty noticeable upgrade. Here are those same two pieces maxed out in the printer. And of course with the printer, you can get every size in between.
Can I mold my sculptures up in a bunch of different pieces and then assemble it after I cast them? Yes, but that is an excessive amount of work.
So there's also the issue of volume. Casting this in solid resin would just be ridiculous. This is a 2-gallon kit of casting resin that costs $120. And I did the math here. The volume of this piece is 1.35 gallons. So this piece would be about $80 worth of casting resin. So if I look at my printing data here, it shows me that that piece uses 576 milliliters of resin. This is a 1-liter cartridge of the white printer resin. This company's from Canada, so they use liters. You get two cartridges that fit into the machine here. So 576 milliliters of this $150 liter container also works out to $80 worth of resin. So casting resin, printing resin, this figure, $80, but that's not exactly a fair and accurate comparison because the 3D printer model is printed hollow. So if you're talking just about the comparison and cost of the resin, definitely a pro on this side because this resin will go a lot further. The 3D printing resin is a lot more expensive. But that being said, I think that being able to print this hollow is definitely a pro for the 3D printing side because I don't have to worry about casting a gallon and a half resin in my studio. One of my least favorite parts of this entire process is the resin casting, and mainly because of all the chemicals and toxins from the casting resin, from the fuming of the casting resin, from the silicone mold, from the mold release. I am more than happy to cut all of that stuff out and move to this system here, which is a lot better. That's not to say that this is completely chemical free. I still wear my respirator when I pull it out of the 3D printer and when I wash it in the isopropyl alcohol, but a lot cleaner than this system over here.
This is a failed print, but it's a really good example of what a hollow print looks like on the inside. This is printed at 2 millimeters thick. All of this little roller coaster scaffolding, this is the internal support structure that is pretty much in all of the hollow prints.
But I always like to add a little bit of lead shot back into the piece just to give it a little bit more weight. I just like the feel of a heavier piece. If you look at this bare piece, you can see that there's lead shot filling up the legs and even the little bottom spot right here. And then I'll glue it in with a little bit of casting resin. And then an added bonus is that this piece that looks like it might be pretty precarious because you have all this heavy weight in the bottom, it's definitely a lot more stable.
So that's just like a little extra cost for my process. So the cost comparison is always a little bit fuzzy.
With the silicone molds, there's something called rotocasting, where you lock the mold into this machine that spins it around and around and up and down and can also create a hollow shell. But that requires a whole nother setup, and it has a lot of limitations. Another thing I don't like about the silicone molds is that it limits your designs. Here's how my process works in a nutshell. First, I encase it in a block of silicone. This becomes my silicone mold. Then I cut the mold open, pull the figure out, then I pour the resin into the negative and get another positive. I have a bunch of tutorials on how to make silicone molds and cast resin on my channel. If you want to check it out, the link up in the top right corner here, this goes to my most popular one called How to Cast Resin. So how do molds limit your designs? As soon as I start designing a figure, I have to think about how it's going to work with this process. Specifically, where I'm going to pour the resin in and how it's going to flow into every little corner and not trap air bubbles. And then how I'm going to cut it out of the mold. Let's say you made a figure that had a bunch of spiky things on the bottom, and it had antlers, and it had a spiral tail pointing backwards, and it had a hand pointing frontwards that was shooting lightning bolts. This would be a nightmare to mold and cast, and honestly, I wouldn't even consider it. If you pour from the top here, you're trapping air in the antlers. If you pour from the bottom, you're trapping air in the little spiky things. And then you still have to deal with how you're going to get resin into all of these little lightning bolts and tail. I could attach a whole bunch of air vents, but that would just turn into a big mess, especially when I was trying to engineer how I was going to remove it from the mold.
But I don't really have to worry about any of that with the 3D printer. Here is that pointer figure printed almost at max size in the printer, one solid piece that could literally have lightning bolts shooting out from every direction if I wanted to, and the printer would still pick all of that up. And obviously much bigger than the silicone mold piece, so again with the size limitation. So if you look at the mold for this piece, what I ended up doing was pouring the resin into the butt here and then using the legs as their own little air vents, because the most important thing was to get the detail in the finger here. So I wanted the resin to just smoothly and cleanly flow down here to pick up all this detail. And this is kind of the end result of that mold. There's where it poured into the butt. And you can see that the resin kind of goes down here and then goes up into these little air vent legs. But I actually ended up casting the wings separately because, you know, there was no way it would be a giant silicone mold and it wouldn't fit in the pressure pot.
So I have the silicone system here with a mold that's a little bit tricky and resin that definitely needs to be cleaned up, as well as pieces that need to be attached. Or on the printer side here, I have this piece that comes out as a single solid unit, no assembly required. But there is quite a bit of work on the front end to get each piece prepped for the printer. You do have to learn a couple of programs, some type of modeling program, and then there's Formlab software, which will help you build this support structure. It's very easy to load a model into the printer and hit the default print and get a solid print of something, but there's a lot of fine tuning to get everything as efficient as possible. I would say it took me a couple of years to feel like I can finally get it to do what I want. So there's definitely a learning curve, but I wouldn't necessarily say that that's a con, because everything has a learning curve to some extent. And I actually feel like this one's not even that bad. The software is very easy to learn. And Formlabs has awesome customer service. I think the biggest real learning curve is just the R&D of figuring out how to make everything work specifically for my work.
But that was an expensive bit of R&D. I have hundreds of dollars worth of failed prints. Here is one back when I was experimenting with 5mm thickness. And here's one of my earliest prints that I printed solid. This took a crazy amount of hours to print, and right before it was about to finish, the power in my house went off, so it just didn't pick up the last little bit of the feet here.
That got me to buy this little backup battery, the CyberPower 1500, and this will, if the power goes out, this will keep the machine running for like a solid 25 minutes. So that is another little added expense for the 3D printer system.
If we look at a general cost comparison, the 3D printing is definitely more expensive, especially for the initial startup costs.
The startup cost for my silicone and cast resin process is close to $1,000.
The pressure pot is $300, $150 for the casting resin, $215 for the silicone, air compressor $150, $60 for a good respirator with cartridges, $20 for the mold release, and about $15 for a box of latex or nitrile gloves, which you will use a lot of.
And once you add in all the smaller consumables like X-Acto knives, glue sticks, stir sticks, cups, you're definitely at the $1,000 mark. But you can also buy in at a much cheaper price. You can buy pint kits instead of the gallons. You can get a smaller pressure pot, or you can even go without the pressure casting and the silicone degassing completely. You can easily cast resin without that setup and still get good results. On the printer side, you're starting out at 11K for the basic package, and then that jumps up to 22.5K for the complete package. And you can keep going higher from there. There's a pro service plan, extended warranties, and then of course shipping and tax. I requested a quote on their website for the premier package with everything, including a 2-year service plan and 2-year warranties on everything, and it came out to just over $31,000. But if you're on a budget, you might not need all of that stuff. Their washing and curing system are very nice pieces of efficient technology, but my totally analog system with buckets for rinsing and natural sunlight for curing works just fine. I got the basic package with 4 liters of resin and the 1-year pro plan and made it out for just under $14,000. Formlabs likes to personalize each printer with a name instead of a serial number, so they can track the machine for troubleshooting and repairs and probably to make sure you aren't making bombs. It's always some adjective-noun combination. My printer's name is Gentle Pato, or Poto, which is a type of lemur found in Africa, so I'm okay with that. This lady's machine was named Humorous Pig, and she wasn't very happy about it. And unfortunately for her, you can't change the name.
You can also get the smaller unit for a lot less money, but this is only really an option if you're printing small because the build volume goes way down. It's about 5 times smaller than the 3L in terms of cubic inches. But you also have to factor in consumables to the cost breakdown here. Since buying my 3D printer almost exactly 2 years ago, I've spent about $8,200 on resin and replacement resin tanks, and that's as a casual user. This is the resin tank right here. It's about $300, and it's recommended that you should replace it every 600 to 800 hours of printing. I'm pushing almost 1,000 hours on this one, but you definitely notice a quality issue as it starts to wear down. And then you have the isopropyl alcohol, which every print needs to be rinsed in. And you could see here that it gets cloudy over time and it needs to be replaced. A 5-gallon bucket is about $100, but it actually lasts quite a while. But overall, definitely more expensive than the silicone mold process concerning consumables.
Let's compare the surface detail, print quality versus casting quality. Here I would say the silicone mold wins hands down. The reproduction is perfect. It'll pick up fingerprints, it'll pick up hairs. If you mix and pour the silicone and resin correctly, it is an exact replica. You will have to deal with cleaning up a little bit of flashing sometimes. That's right where the seam of the mold is. But if your mold is efficient and tight, it's very easy to clean this stuff up. You'll also have to clean up the pore spout, and sometimes you have air vents you have to clean up and possibly fill in holes from air bubbles, especially if you skip the pressure casting process. 3D printers aren't quite there yet, even the really expensive ones. I would say the print quality of my machine is very good, but it definitely is not perfect. And I think it's going to be a while before they can match that.
Most printers are building up the prints layer by tiny layer. On my printer, this platform goes down into this bed of resin over and over and over again. And each time it goes down and touches this film, a little laser comes on and cures a tiny layer of resin, and it just keeps building the entire piece up, tiny layer by tiny layer.
Here's a little time lapse of the process. It's actually a very slow process. I have had some prints take up to 5 days to complete. My highest printing setting is 0.050 millimeters, which is 50 microns. A human hair is about 70 microns, so each one of these layers is tiny. But even at that size, it's still never going to be perfectly smooth. This finger piece was printed at 100 microns, so you can definitely see a texture if you zoom in.
But when you get down to 50 microns, that texture is barely noticeable, especially in my case when I'm finishing the piece off with paints, a lot of different layers and a lot of dry brushing.
There's also a fair amount of cleanup on the 3D prints as well. There's always some sanding involved, especially to remove this chicken skin texture that the supports leave. The area where the majority of your supports are clustered is always going to need the most cleanup, and that's always the north position because that's where it attaches to the build plate. So how you set up and orient your model is an important factor in creating the most efficient print. I always set mine up so the scaffolding is along the back and bottom here where sanding isn't as big of an issue. That way I'm not messing up any of the detail on the front. And remember how I said silicone will pick up fingerprints? This is my fingerprint right here on the figure's nose, just blown up in scale. You can actually see the original fingerprint from the casting I scanned right here. So the scanning and enlarging technology totally works. Scanning is also something that I have to factor into costs because 90% of what I print starts out as a handmade sculpture. This is the Creaform Metroscan Black Elite Scanner. It's one of the best scanners out there, but it costs about $20,000. That is a bit too much money for me right now, and I also don't want to spend 6 months learning the scanning software that looks kind of complicated. But I'm convinced that you need the best scan possible, so I'm farming my scans out to a company called ScanSight in Novato, California that uses this scanner. Each one of my figures costs around $200 to $500 for the scan and cleanup. The $500 piece was this giant 5-foot felt piece, but check out this cool felt texture in the printed resin. And here it is with a rainbow sparkle automotive paint. There are definitely cheaper ways to get a scan, like this website Art Lab, but I like ScanSight because they deal with all my annoying special requests and I always know that the detail will be perfect. Maintenance is something worth mentioning too. On the printer side, there's a fair amount of this, like this print cleaning mesh right here. Here I am pulling the mesh out of the resin bed. You can print this up to clean up your resin or collect any debris from failed prints. There are also diagnostics you can run on all sorts of stuff and regular updates to download. And while it sounds like a pain in the butt, I'm very impressed with the improvements Formlab's updates have made over the past 2 years, especially when they bumped up the print quality last year from 0.1 millimeter to 0.05 millimeter per layer. That was a serious game changer. Molds, on the other hand, require almost no maintenance. Keep them in a room temperature locker and they'll last forever. I do like to clean them out a bit and give them a light powdering before I store them. So to answer the big question, is 3D printing worth it? For me, it's a definite yes. What I really like about this machine is that the more I play around with it and the software, the more I realize I've just barely scratched the surface of what I can do with it. Here's a staff head for this cast bronze Guardian figure I made. The top half is a taillight from a 59 Cadillac, but the bottom half was 3D printed and then chromed. So the possibilities of merging hand-sculpted work with 3D models really presents just unlimited possibilities here. In part two of this series, I'm going to take this figure and run it through the entire process to get to this figure here. So a general overview of how everything works with a 3D printer. The scanning, prepping the model, printing it, and then cleaning and finishing it so it's ready to paint. Let me know in the comments below who you think would win in an epic battle of good versus evil between the homeless wizard puppet and my cat Midge.
Hey, get out. Psst, psst. Go. Get away.